CrowdStrike stops breaches. These days, critical work isn't done from the protection of a corporate network. It happens at cafes, back offices, and at home. New ways of working mean new attacks. New attacks require new defenses. CrowdStrike stops breaches so you can do what you do best. CrowdStrike, we stop so you can go. CrowdStrike is offering Security Weekly listeners 15 days free access to its platform. See how it works at securityweekly.com/CrowdStrike. The question is simple. Have any of the systems on my network been compromised? The answer is harder than it should be. Enter AI Hunter. Active Countermeasures has automated and streamlined techniques used by the best pen testers and threat hunters in the industry to create AI Hunter, a network threat hunting solution that does the first pass of a hunt for you to identify systems that are most likely to be compromised and scores the results on a scale from 0 to 100. You can then research those systems in depth with AI Hunter. Focus your valuable time on the systems that need your expertise with AI Hunter. Sign up for a personal demo today at securityweekly.com/ACM. Welcome back, everyone, to Enterprise Security Weekly. B-Sides Boston is back in action for their 10-year anniversary. The conference will be held on Saturday, September 26th. Tickets are only $10. You can get yours at bsidesbos.org. Some of the Security Weekly team will be in our own channel on the B-Sides Boston Discord server, answering questions and possibly doing some contests, plural. Corey Williams is the head of identity security marketing at CyberArk and the former vice president of marketing for Idaptive. He joins us today to talk about exploring identity security and its role in the modern enterprise. You can learn more by visiting securityweekly.com/CyberArk. Corey, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks for having me. It's great to be here.
Corey, I guess for I wanted to start first talking about CyberArk, Idaptive. We know what CyberArk does largely. Idaptive was just being acquired, I think, when we did a previous interview. And they were like, we're kind of figuring things out. So it's wonderful to have you here today to talk about what Idaptive brings into the CyberArk family.
Sure. Yeah. It's been very exciting times here for the last few months, getting to know this great CyberArk team. They really have a great reputation in the industry, and we're finding a ton of synergy. Idaptive is one of the leading technologies. If you look at some of the like analyst rankings, we're one of the leading technologies in what's called the access management space, or identity as a service, providing capabilities like single sign-on, adaptive multi-factor authentication, provisioning, and some other capabilities around mobile context that's all useful in being able to verify users as they gain access, which made us a great fit with a company like CyberArk, because CyberArk, you know, is protecting those kind of digital keys to the kingdom to access your privileged accounts and other privileges in the enterprise, and that access needs to be protected through a layer like access management. And for many years now, CyberArk has always recommended that as a first step. But they, you know, talking to their customers, we found that they, in some cases, didn't have that layer, if you can believe it. I heard in your last segment there were still VPNs being protected without MFA.
Right.
It's a very common thing. And so, you know, it made a natural fit that we can offer this, if it makes sense, to the CyberArk customer base.
Yeah, and it's interesting, you know, this technology is available as a commodity in certain circumstances. I always use Google as the example, right? They're doing it on a very much commodity basis. They're dealing with millions of users. Anyone in the public can go sign up for a Gmail account, for example. And you get some of this technology as part of that, right? If you log into your Gmail from a different machine or a different IP address, it goes, whoa, wait, we need your password. We need your two-factor authentication and things like that. What I believe Idaptive technology brings to the table in the CyberArk portfolio is the ability to customize this for all of your applications in the enterprise and integrate fully so your users get the full benefits of this technology. Did I capture that correctly?
Yeah, I think you bring up a good point. I mean, we all know that multi-factor authentication is one of the best ways to prevent a stolen password from being used against you. Unfortunately, a study just came out from the Identity Defined Security Alliance that talked to hundreds of enterprises. They're still, 95% of them have seen a breach related to identity. And in the last couple of years, three quarters of those enterprises have seen an identity-related breach. And by far, 2/3 of those breaches started as a phishing attempt, which means that they're still depending on passwords alone to protect assets and access. And that's just a big issue for enterprises. And enterprises have, you know, dozens, if not hundreds, of applications that their end users use. And if Right. we did the kind of commodity route, you'd have a different multi-factor authentication experience for every one of those apps if you adopted it. Mm. And that's just untenable for an enterprise to ask their end users to manage, you know, a dozen different multi-factor authentication experiences. It's just not, it's not a good user experience.
Mm. Matt?
As John was dropping off to, between segments, he was, you know, he made the little joke that, you know, CyberArk makes his life difficult. And from a privileged access perspective, if deployed correctly, it prevents the penetration testers from getting into those systems. What I think is really interesting, Corey, is what Idaptive can now potentially do for those CyberArk customers is make it hard for all access, not just privileged access. And see, this is where I knew the market would eventually go. And it's great to see this because we have to protect our normal users just as much as we do our privileged access accounts. To your point, to prevent these breaches from happening with stolen credentials. So, you know, maybe we can get these organizations to make it difficult for the pen testers across the board.
Yeah, I mean, listen, we all know that multi-factor authentication is a great way to mitigate against a stolen password, but it does put friction into the user's experience. And it's one of the reasons Idaptive's name is a combination of identity and adaptive. You need to have a much smarter approach than just continually prompting someone for an extra factor or two of authentication. I mean, listen, you guys are the experts, right? But security, in my mind, is easy. Just unplug everything from the internet and light it on fire, and we won't have any more breaches. Mm-hmm. But it drives productivity to zero. And I think that's why you need to focus on how you can, especially with end users. It's one thing to put a little extra friction in front of an IT admin, and they just kind of are used to it as part of their job, part of the regulatory requirements and hurdles that they have to jump over. But from a business user point of view, you can't be constantly prompting them. So what Idaptive does is by centralizing that experience, we can give them a broad range of factor choices that give them a experience that is easy for them, like Windows Hello or Touch ID or a YubiKey factor. Those are all stronger authentication mechanisms than a password alone. But we can also apply machine learning algorithms to learn what a typical behavior pattern is for that user and only, you know, and then use that to determine the risk level of that access attempt. And if it's a lower level risk, I'm accessing the same app I do that's not real high risk at the same time of day, then maybe I don't need to prompt them at all. And we can use something like single sign-on to give them a passwordless experience right to their app. And I think that that balance is what is new in identity and access management. All this innovation is leading up to a balance by keeping the risk levels low or addressing, introducing risk only when the risk is high. Introducing friction only when the risk is high.
Mm. And is the goal to be passwordless, Corey? I know you mentioned that earlier. We didn't really, you know, talk about that much. And I know there's a lot of solutions out there that are really pushing passwordless hard. It sounds like your approach is very much like you're in control over what happens when the user signs in and how they're challenged, right?
Correct. And, you know, passwordless is, it's one of those terms, you know, us marketing guys, right? We get on our role and we start labeling everything. Passwordless kind of has two meanings in my mind. One is the kind of strict, we're going to get rid of passwords. We're going to use alternate mechanisms of authentication that are more ephemeral, token-based, key-based, things that don't require a secret. But we're technology experts. We've been around for a long time. Any technology you build is going to be around for 40, 50 years. You can't get rid of passwords. What you can do is eliminate the password as the vulnerability mechanism by introducing these better experiences for end users that obfuscate or hide or proxy that password with additional layers of authentication that are in that passwordless realm where you don't have to remember a secret.
And the real goal in all of your authentication and authorization is to cover as much as possible. When I talk to pen testers and they're like, oh yeah, it's great. Like they had multi-factor authentication, but there was this other service that accesses the same directory service and that didn't have multi-factor and therefore we can password spray that all day long, right? What advice do you have for your customers and potential customers to make sure they're covering all of their services? Because that's very important in the context of this discussion.
Well, yeah, I mean, listen, you know, hackers are smart, right? The attackers are going to follow the path of least resistance. Mm-hmm. It's like water flowing downhill. They're going to go right where the vulnerability is, right where that crack is. And it's almost always going to be through a password gate alone. It's too much work to go another route.
My son did this to me the other day. I said, you know, if you want to get bypass the parental controls to get more time, I'm like, you can hack your way in and you won't be in trouble for that, right? And so he picks up my wife's phone. He knew her passcode, goes into the management software, enables more time on his computer, and he's off to the races. I'm like, dude, you win. Like, you win the internet for today, right? Because that's what attackers do. I'm like, you sure you don't want to be in this industry? Because, like, you got the right mindset for it, right?
Yeah. For all the layers of security that we develop, it's like building stronger and stronger bars for the windows. Mm. And everyone's just walking through the door that's you know, has a lightly guarded key. Mm-hmm. And I think we've got to keep the beating this mantra of access management. But we've got to do it in a way that doesn't provides the level of security you need for the business. But B, not only does it not put an unneeded amount of friction in front of end users, it actually becomes an enabling technology for the new business. I mean, identity is at its heart does have a lot to do with controlling access and who should be allowed to do what and when. But really what identity is about in the long term is about enabling great experiences, right? Having a seamless experience navigating different applications, being able to feel like, as a customer of an application, right? I want to make sure I feel that this is a secure place to trust my personal data. And I think that is as much the goal of identity as it is security. It's to balance the productivity and the security, is to balance the user experience and the risk level, and to break that teeter-totter where we always felt like we had to make one choice or the other.
Mm.
Yeah. And I think the environment that we're in makes this even more important for us to get right, because now we have a lot of users working from home that are logging into systems, and we've lost some of those centralized controls that we used to have in place. So, I mean, identity is playing a much bigger role in the way we're not only going to work in the future, but also how do we secure ourselves in this concept of a zero trust model?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, actually, I'm glad you brought up zero trust, because I do think it outlines a really interesting way to frame the discussion, because we talk a lot about identity in terms of the end user. And his ability to log into something, right? And you want to do a good job of validating or verifying who that user is. And that's why we use things like multi-factor authentication, why we try to reduce the use of passwords. But there's more to it than that. With zero trust, you want to reduce the attack surface to just the people who should have access, but also reduce the attack surface from every device on Earth down to just the devices that should be used in your organization. I think Google did something called Beyond Corp, which was a precursor to sort of modern day zero trust from an identity perspective. And the second element of that is to validate every device so that you know that device is associated with that end user. The way that Idaptive does it is we put a certificate on that device and associate it with the end user, but also determine the security posture of that device so that it can be used as a contextual element in access. Are they using a trusted registered device? Okay, we give them access. Otherwise, we don't. And that's transparent to the end user, but it adds a great level of security. And then if you combine that with the privilege side, right? If you look at ransomware or most malware, it's targeting the local administrator privilege. They're trying to elevate their access so that they get freer rein to jump off of that box into other areas. And so if you can lock down that local admin, take it out of the hands of the user and provide just back the controls that they need to do things like add printers or install applications, then you have a device that's secure, and you can trust that access is being done by the right person. So it's a combination of device level capability and security and end user security to give you that true zero trust approach, at least for the, you know, employees of an enterprise.
Yeah, I think the user experience, when we talk about the benefits of a physical token versus an authenticator app versus SMS, right? I mean, there's some pretty fine lines in the sand, right, between those three different mechanisms. And yeah. I think the physical token has far more security benefits. But as I like the teeter totter, right? When you talk about usability, not so much. If I have to have my physical token every time I log in to every single different service, I'm like, wait, where did I put that? Where is it now? Now it's upstairs. How do I get on my phone? NFC doesn't work with, OS update on Android, blah, 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 blah. It's a huge inconvenience. I mean, I've been there with YubiKey trying to make it work with my various services, right? And what you end up with is more physical tokens, right? Which I don't know if that, I think you take a hit on the security side for a little more usability there, but it's a pain in the butt. We want to remove that friction from the user to, as you said, give them a better experience so that it knows that Paul is Paul. And I guess my question is from the Idaptive side, what can be measured and incorporated into the basically proving that the person is who they say they are?
Yeah, and that's where context comes into play. Part of it is the token that they use, and there are different levels of assurance, and NIST has done a good job of outlining those, right? So something like a YubiKey is much better than a one-time password code that's sent over SMS or generated from an Oath token. I think that the key is to take the level of assurance that you're getting in terms of the factors that you get, but also look at the context. And being contextually aware is the big breakthrough in identity and access management. That's where hundreds of millions of dollars have been spent to apply algorithms to understand the location of the device, the posture of the device, the understanding of what a user's normal behavior is, when he typically accesses something, when is the last time he accessed something. You heard about like the impossible traveler, right? So I'm using an application in New York, but 15 minutes later, I'm logging into something from London. That doesn't make any sense. And so all of those contextual factors, you can write rules for those. It becomes very difficult, though, to write rules that apply to every individual employee, because a guy working at headquarters, well, first of all, now he's working at home. A guy working from home in finance is probably not traveling up and down the East Coast like a sales guy is. And so you end up needing something like a machine learning AI-based approach to learn the individual patterns of each user. And there are standalone products that do that. You've probably heard of user behavior analytics type of applications, but those tend to give you a static score that you can then import into an access management system. They're not practical to call in real time, especially if you're trying to reduce the latency, like in an automation environment. Because identity, as you know, and back to your original point, that identity controls need to be put in place everywhere, not just for a certain silo of the organization and not just for human users. There's also non-human actors all over the place. All of these automation scripts that we put in to manage the systems or to do process automation, robotic process automation. All of the applications have layers that have to call each other. APIs have to call each other, and they have all the same access characteristics that an end user does. Is this a caller that I can trust? And what is the context of this call? And what is the history of this? And we try to do that by segmenting everything down to the narrowest layer, but we always miss something. And so it's better to have a layer that can learn what a typical behavior is in the automation and apply it that way.
Yeah, because Corey, how do you deal with the situation where I might be in New York, but now I remotely access a server in London and I'm logging into something, right? You need a system to manage and know that that's happening, that it's not Paul actually being in two places at once. I mean, I am virtually, but the system knows that, right? And can broker that access.
Yeah. And I think so the how you react to it is not just allow or block, right? You can have a nuance. It may be that, hey, this is an unusual situation. I haven't seen it before. And then what I want to do is re-authenticate you. I want to step up authentication, ask you to provide another or a better level of assurance that is who you say you are. And that's going to be based a lot on the risk of what you're trying to access, right? I think that's one piece of it. The other piece of it is that you got to close the loop in other areas. Maybe it's enough to just continue letting them to do their work, but now I'm going to send a notification now to the SOC monitors so that they can look into whether or not that user should have what they said. what they're asking for. And so I think you kind of have to look at those use cases and decide what the risk is to your business and then respond appropriately. And so you want to look for environments that don't just measure the risk, but also allow you to configure the result of that risk level. As it gets higher, you can put more friction in front of the user, you can block access, or you can kick off other workflows to remediate it. We've gone so far as to see people, hey, the obvious case, right? Someone accesses with a password from China from a device I've never seen before, accessing an app that I haven't used in 3 months. I'm going to block access. I'm also going to go back to Active Directory and lock his account until I find out what's going on. And that automation is important. So the automation logic is a big piece of how we should be moving our logic from writing rules to detect situations to writing the responses to these different use cases and how to appropriately defend them.
Yeah, and I think what's important that you kind of described, Corey, is those responses are going to vary based on lots of different factors. Because we all know what happens when you shut off the account, you lock the AD account, and it happens to be the CEO of the company because we all get in trouble for those, right? So you've got to have some level of configurability to make those rules appropriate for the different scenarios, because one size definitely does not fit all in when it comes to automated remediation.
Yeah, and as you put more sophistication into your authentication layer, you also want to do a better job of delivering a level of self-service so that users can, for instance, register the factors that they want to use. You know, maybe they do like everything tied to a Google Authenticator, and you're okay with that being used. They should be able to register that with the environment or with the YubiKey or with their own device for like Windows Hello or Touch ID. So that's one element. Part of that self-service is also being able to do things like self-service password reset, account unlock. You know, a lot of these accounts. Well, I do it just because I want to test the thing, but everyone always lets their password run out and now they've locked themselves out and it becomes a help desk ticket. With a solution like this, you should be able to just go in, log in, and it'll ask you for some of those extra factors of authentication and unlock your account kind of in real time so that it's seamless to the end user. But you're forcing them through a level of friction that's appropriate for that situation. Because if the CEO's account does get compromised and you legitimately lock his account and ask him to do something, yeah, it's inconvenient. But that's the level of decision you've made for that business that, hey, the CEO has been hacked. It makes sense to cut off some of his access until we find out what's going on. So you really have to balance that. And this is an issue. Without these usability features, you're not going to get buy-in from the leadership team across the board. And so you bring up an excellent point. Once we start to move these controls outside of just IT and to the end user, you've got to have a way of rolling it out smoothly, of being able to let users have a lot of self-service and visibility into their own environment. And I think that a lot of consumer-based companies have done this well. I know personally that Yahoo, after that terrible breach, I'm still a Yahoo user, but I almost left them because it was such an egregious breach that they allowed it to happen. But they ended up responding with a pretty good self-service experience for multi-factor authentication. Google's always had a fairly good one available.
Not every bank, like E-Trade,
has a terrible experience. Yeah. You have to carry around a soft token and stuff.
My wife, with the bank, sometimes she loses it because it creates too much friction. And with her work too, she has to bring me in, and we get to a point and I'm like, I know you hate it when I say this, but you're going to have to call the help desk. Like, I can't help you. Like, they need to, I can't unlock your account without unlawfully breaking into your company, which would be bad. Yeah, yeah. You don't do that. I don't have permission. You're going to have to call the help desk. I'm sorry. And she hates that.
Yeah. Yeah, and that is the big conundrum that has to be solved by security. We can't be security for security's sake. We have to be security to enable the business to become more, to operate faster and with more confidence. So it is a balance.
Yep.
Yeah, my biggest challenge these days is my biometric phone. It went to Face ID, and it doesn't recognize your face when you're wearing a mask, so it just created more friction for me. So.
Yeah, the mask.
I was glad that. Go ahead.
I was just saying the mask is troubling. Mine recognizes when I have a cigar in my mouth, which is convenient.
this is not a laundry day, but on laundry day, I'm always wearing a hat. So I'm glad that it recognizes me with a hat on. Mm. I think that, one of the keys to look at this, and CyberArk is sort of known for privilege access management, right? They invented the space. They're the leaders in that, the only public company in the space, standalone company. And what the realization with kind of looking at broader identity security is that all users end up becoming privileged at some point during the day.
Certain level of privilege, and, right? Yep.
And yeah, I mean, think about all the line of business people in an enterprise that do privilege elevated things. They are granting access to Salesforce. They are running a report for the CEO. Those aren't done by a typical IT admin. They're done by the business analysts that actually run the business. And those are all privileged things. I mean, even posting on Twitter, if you think about it, it's a privileged activity because I'm speaking on behalf of the company. And we know what happens when those get out of hand. Mm-hmm. In fact, Twitter is a great example that we now know that insider, you know, had access to these kind of support level tools that allowed them to do some account takeovers. And it was something that ended up being a not a typical IT privileged use case. It was a business privilege use case. And so I think kind of thinking about privilege in a broader way is one way of doing it. It's at least a way to bridge the minds of people in security and IT when they start thinking beyond just the, you know, outsourced IT, third-party vendors, and IT admins from a privilege point of view.
Matt, more questions for Corey?
No, I'm good. Thank you.
Corey, anything else you want to share with the audience today?
Yeah, I mean, I think just to sum it up, you know, I appreciate the time. This is a perfect discussion. I do think that the swim lanes are starting to blur a little bit in identity, but I think it's less about pure consolidation. And I think it's more about the realization that we need to have a comprehensive approach to identity security. Identity security at the end of the day is about being contextually aware, as we talked about, having a security mindset when you do identity things, but balancing that user experience so that you are enabling the business, not just being the department of no and high friction, but that you're adding friction that makes sense. I personally don't mind when I get a fraud alert from Chase saying, hey, is this really you that made this purchase at this gas station you've never been at? That gives me a sense of peace of mind. I'm glad they didn't make me go inside to have to unlock the credit card first, but they had the appropriate level response to the risk level that was there. And I think that adaptive behavior, that more automatic behavior, is the future of identity and access. And that's what I'm excited about, having worked in this for, 15 years. And now with a great company like CyberArk, I'm excited to see how we can take this identity security vision, all the way over the next few years.
Fantastic. Corey, thank you so much for appearing on Enterprise Security Weekly. Our listeners can find out more at securityweekly.com/CyberArk. With that, we'll take a short break and come back with Braden from Mimecast. Stay tuned.